We got. I got the invitation to go on this armed Lutheran radio show, though. You know this guy? Have you seen this? I got. There's two things that I would like to say that make me feel safe. Number one, the fact that there is a radio show called the Armed Lutheran Podcast somewhere in the world. That makes me feel safe.
Pistols, prayer, and potluck. This is Armed Lutheran Radio.
Hey, folks. Welcome to another episode of Armed Lutheran Radio, a show about guns, hunting, competitive shooting, the natural right of self-defense, and what God's Word says about the issues surrounding gun rights and gun ownership. I am your host, Lloyd Bailey, the Armed Lutheran, and this is episode number 397. Thank you so much for making Armed Lutheran Radio a part of your week. Again this week, for those of you who are new, welcome aboard. It is wonderful to have you. Hope you will stick around, come back for more Armed Lutheran Radio goodness in the future. Maybe check out the website at armedlutheran.us and peruse the back catalog of 390... Let's see, there's 396 previous episodes of Armed Lutheran Radio and a dozen or so midweek meditations, we used to call them back in the early days. So there's well over 400 episodes out there now, and we're approaching officially the 400th episode of Armed Lutheran Radio here in about 3 weeks. So go and check all that stuff out if you're new. Hope you will do that, and hope you enjoy what you hear, and you'll keep coming back. My apologies first off for those of you longtime listeners or who were looking for the show last week for not releasing a show last weekend. It was another long weekend of volleyballing, this time at the Gaylord Resort in National Harbor, Maryland, for the Northeastern Qualifier. Yes, we traveled all the way across the country to play 3 days of volleyball, to finish it up with a game against a team that is 12 miles away from us. It was a long weekend, a lot of fun, and I thought about doing an episode about, you know, travel and all of that stuff, but we were just so exhausted when we did get back that didn't really have a lot in the tank for putting together a show, so you'll just have to wait for today, and I'm glad you did. Today, well, we'll get into what we're talking about today here in a minute, but a couple of things I do want to talk about real quick before I get started with today's topic. A little bit of housekeeping, as I like to say, and a big announcement. The second book in my Ten Commands series called Forsaking All Others came out yesterday. Came out yesterday on Saturday in time for my daughter's 14th birthday. For those of you who don't know, it is the series follows the adventures of four characters who are loosely based on your four favorite podcasters. They have some fun adventures, they meet amazing people, do some amazing things, learn some important biblical truths about government, love of neighbor, faith, sacrifice, marriage, and forgiveness, and much more. There's even reading guides for you to read these books with young readers. They're intended for ages 12 and up. I probably go, I'm going to leave it to you. Only you know your young readers. So, I mean, you might be even able to go down to age 10. There's not a whole lot in it that you would find objectionable unless you like fart jokes occasionally. There's no sex, there's no graphic violence. There's a little bit of violence, not a whole lot. And even that is fairly tame. But everything is told with an eye towards learning a lesson, teaching a lesson, rooted in biblical truth. And, I think you will enjoy it. At least I hope you will. There are some signed copies of both the first and the second book. The first book was called The Fifth Command. The second is called Forsaking All Others. And, there are some signed copies available now. If you would like to go look for those on armedlutheran.us/books, I don't think I have, I need to put the signed copies of the first book back on the store, and I need to put together a bundle of both books to offer you a special price as well. There's also going to be EPUB versions available soon, and there'll be a bundle of those. There's a Kindle version coming soon. That'll be done and released by the end of the week. But I do know that signed copies of Forsaking All Others, the latest one, is available on the website right now. And both books are available at Amazon.com. And just as a tease, the third book in the series is already underway. I had an idea for what the third book would be about. It's going to be called, tentatively going to be called, The Best Construction, which for those of you who know your catechism, you will, as you might have guessed, it's about, it's focused on the Eighth Commandment. But that's a long way out, probably at the earliest Christmas. So more on that later this year. And then one more announcement, of course, Armed Lutheran Radio is listener funded. We don't have any advertising. We don't have any sponsors. We rely on the generosity of our listeners, specifically members of the Reformation Gun Club, who help keep the lights on. People like Keith from Palmyra, Missouri, Luke from Seymour, Indiana, Jerry and Billy from Deer Lodge, Montana, Donnie from White Bear Lake, Minnesota, Mark from Lake Havasu City, Arizona, Paul from right here in McKinney, Texas, Stuart from Pensacola, Florida, Greg from Holly, Michigan, JJ from Toms River, New Jersey, and Daniel from Chehalis, Washington, and many more. Thank you all so much for your support. I really do appreciate it. If you would like to join these great people, get access to some exclusive content, some cool swag, and invitations to our monthly online hangouts, be sure to visit reformationgunclub.com and come sign up today. The next online hangout will be a couple of weeks toward the end of the month. Next weekend is the very last. It's the last volleyball tournament of the season. We'll be trying to get together with Pastor Bennett for next week's show, and then probably the week after that, or probably in the final 2 weeks of the month, we'll have our next online hangout. And of course, with volleyball season aside, things will start to smooth out a little bit, and we won't be running late or missing weeks, hopefully. So, all right, with all that said, what are we talking about today? Well, to be honest, I have no idea. I am so out of the loop on things that it's really not funny. And I guess actually that is what today is about. When you watch the news, when you check in on social media, it's really easy to become depressed, despondent, angry. If I pick up my phone to look for some info that I really actually need, it never fails. Tell me if this is you. It never fails that I find myself drawn to notifications about this or that and completely lose track of what did I originally pick my phone up for? What was I looking for in the first place? And it never fails. It's what grabs your attention. It's the latest outrage about the state of the nation, the latest cultural controversy or insanity, the newest and infuriating bit of gaslighting from our idiot president, something stupid that Trump said, the threat of war, mounting national debt. It really is amazing the amount of emotional energy that we waste on social media. If I open X, I've gotten back on X. I stopped using it for a long time. Once Elon Musk purchased X, I got back on there, but I don't use it a whole lot. I really don't post anything there. I just peruse the latest. But it's a guarantee that if I do open X, formerly Twitter, by the way, for those who don't know, it's a guarantee that I'm going to end up posting a response to something that I will later regret. It is inevitable. I know X is a free and open discussion now, thanks to Elon Musk, but it's still not healthy. Far from being the public forum that Musk wants it to be, it really feels like more like the Coliseum, where it's just a blood sport, and every discussion is fought to the rhetorical death. There's so much information that hits us and infuriates us that it's hard to focus on just one, and maybe that's the point. Maybe that's what the government wants, is just to keep hitting us with so much stuff that we just become overwhelmed and we miss the stuff that's really important. But that's enough of my tinfoil hat for today. It's easy, really easy, to get dragged into electronic violations of the fifth or the eighth commandments. There's that old adage that if you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all, right? You've probably heard this in some form. And that's good advice in life, but especially in using social media. Now, the nastiness that we see in American political discourse, I believe, and I've said this many times on the show, I believe it got started with the Clintons and their politics of personal destruction. Back before Clinton, if you opposed someone's ideas, that was common, that was fine. You could argue and bitterly argue with one another and then go out to dinner with that person later. The famous example of Ronald Reagan and the Speaker of the House, Democrat Tip O'Neill, who would be just vicious in their attacks on one another's ideas and then go out for dinner or drinks afterwards. If you oppose their ideas, you can still have a conversation about their ideas, about your ideas. But if you oppose that person because they're evil, then there's no more room for compromise or conversation. Because if you do that, then you risk alienating your own base, your own people that you've told, this person is an evil SOB. Don't vote for them. They're not just wrong, they're evil. But then if you go work with them, the people that you told that you said to those people, this person is evil and terrible, they're going to look at you like, what's wrong with you? How can you work with them after telling us that they're evil? You told us not to vote for them because they're an evil person, because their motivations are evil, and now you're working with them? And if we can't stop doing that on both sides of the aisle, on both ends of the political spectrum, we cannot move forward in this country. And that mindset is playing itself out everywhere, beyond that wretched hive of scum and villainy in Washington, D.C. The people we elect are a big part of the problem. We are electing brainless twits who post vile and angry statements about the other people, that the people that they oppose in Congress or on the other side of the political aisle, in a quest for clicks and likes among their followers. The nastier your comments, the more snarky and vile, the better it looks for you among your supporters. And we talked a little about this on our last online hangout. Go back and listen. That was a couple of episodes back. I think the solution to our problem here, and to a lot of our problems, not just our political discourse, is to elect serious people, because we have serious problems with debt and foreign policy and immigration and crime and the economy. And with all of these serious problems, we have very unserious people in Congress on both sides. This is no longer just one side problem. It's not just the AOCs and the Cori Bushes and the Ilhan Omars. It's the MTGs and the Lauren Boberts and the Matt Gaetzes and the Ilhan Omars and the Nancy Maces. It's people with the IQ of kumquats who prefer to posture instead of coming up with solutions. And when those people, the people that we elect and send to Congress, when they behave like the average 15-year-old rando on the internet, then it just reinforces that behavior, and every basement-dwelling keyboard commando of all colors and all creeds, it just says to them, this is the way we're supposed to behave. And it needs to end. We all laugh and shake our heads at the dinosaurs like Dianne Feinstein and Joe Biden and Mitch McConnell who hold on to power until they can't walk or talk. But we need not only to change the laws so that we have a maximum age, so that we don't have these elder statesmen who can't speak or think or move, but we also need a minimum age change in order to get more serious people in Congress. Now, I think the minimum age to serve is 25. And to me, that's way, way, way too young. Most 25-year-olds haven't done much living. And they don't know a whole lot. Especially, at 25, they're barely out of college. Those wondrous centers of leftist indoctrination that we call our American higher education system. Maybe they've waited tables or tended bar or been driving Lyft or delivering Uber Eats or something, or they've extended their adolescence by living at home or going back to college, but they haven't been living in the real world for the most part. Even those who come out of college and go or have been in the military, that's not no knock on the military. But that's not the real world. It's certainly better than, AOC's degrees and bartending, but it's still not a whole lot of real world experience. Now, remember, when the Constitution was ratified and they established this minimum age for office, 25 for Congress and 35 for the president, life expectancy was like 38. So most people running for office at 25 were potentially only going to serve for 12 years at most. Now, of course, the founders never envisioned that people would become career politicians either. That's a whole different topic for a whole different episode. And the founders, I think I read, lived on average to age 60. But life expectancy, average life expectancy today, is 78. So numbskulls like AOC can end up serving 50 plus years in Congress. And that's insane. So, in my humble opinion, there are several things I think we ought to do. We should raise the minimum age for office based on life expectancy. When Social Security was created, for example, life expectancy in the U.S. was 60, I think. So most people weren't going to be living. The average person wasn't living till 65 to even get to retire. But today, average life expectancy is 78. And Social Security has essentially become a Ponzi scheme that's bankrupting us. You're retiring at 65 and living to well past 78 on average. That's a lot of money. That's a topic for another day. But in the same way, considering that life expectancy was around 40 when the Constitution was ratified, the idea that a 25-year-old would serve in Congress for 50 years is kind of crazy. So I think in addition to needing a maximum age of, let's say, 75 to prevent us from getting dinosaurs like the Feinsteins and the Bidens and the Trumps, so that they're not serving until they're senile. And I would include Ronald Reagan in that. I mean, remember at the end of Ronald Reagan's last term, Alzheimer's had made him quite senile. Not to the extent that Biden is today, but it happens to everyone. So we need to raise the minimum age to, let's say, 35 to 40 to serve in Congress. Because people living or working in Congress, they need to have lived long enough before entering Congress, before serving in Congress, to understand how life works. Not just the theories of college professors, but real life, running a business, working in the private sector, serving in the military. For president then, since there is a differential, it's 25 currently for Congress and 35 for the president. The idea, of course, the founders wanted people with more experience, more wisdom, more years to serve as president. They wanted somebody who was more seasoned. So the minimum for president should be raised based on the life expectancy then and now. We should probably raise the minimum for president to 45 to 50, somewhere in there. And I think we should review those minimums and adjust them every 10 to 20 years as life expectancy changes. Hopefully the average is increasing as we, as you know, healthcare and technology improves. But you never know if those people like Greta Thunberg and the megalomaniacs at the World Economic Forum, if they have their way, we may need to lower it at some point. Who knows? But the point is, we need serious people in Washington, not senile ones. We need serious people in Washington, not puerile ones either. And today, unfortunately, we have way too many of both. That's what I think. That's my opinion. Of course, these are things that we will never do because, of course, people who vote for those changes would have to vote to reduce their own power. And many of the people who serve in the halls of Congress and in the White House are there for purely selfish reasons, and voting for something like this would not be in their self-interest. That's why we don't have term limits. But who knows? Maybe someone with some principles could suggest it at some point, maybe even exempt the current members of Congress just to make sure that it gets passed. That way the power hungry among us can vote for it. The law won't apply to them. I mean, that's the way they typically do things, right? Vote for laws that don't apply to them. That would take a few election cycles to get rid of the rubbish, but eventually I think we would get to a Congress that's filled with serious, reasonable people and not people who are looking to be celebrities and who care more about themselves and how they look than about serving the country. What do you think? I mean, let me know in the comments if you have any ideas or if you think mine are crazy. Visit the feedback page, armedlutheran.us/feedback, and let me know your thoughts. I'd love to hear from you. As I said, next week, Lord willing, we'll be visiting with Pastor Bennett again. So until then, keep shooting, keep praying. We'll talk to you next time.
For show notes, be sure to visit our website at www.armedlutheran.us. Check out the Facebook page, The Armed Lutheran, or join our Facebook group, Fans of Armed Lutheran Radio. If you like what you hear, please leave us a comment on our feedback page at armedlutheran.us/feedback, or a review on iTunes, and let us know what you think. Thank you for listening to Armed Lutheran Radio, a member of the Self-Defense Radio Network.